There's actually a pretty straightforward and easy way to make your animations in Blender look more interesting. To keep things simple, I will demonstrate things with a cube first. Make sure it's selected and that your mouse is inside the viewport window, and now press I to create a keyframe. By default, it will create a keyframe for the location, rotation, and scale of the object. We will move a few frames forward, move the object, and create another keyframe. You might already know that you can move the keyframes around by either holding down left click or by pressing G to move all selected keyframes. A very crucial thing to understand is that the distance between both keyframes controls the length of the animation and therefore controls how fast your animation will be. Of course, this is also bound to your project frame rate, which I will set to 60 FPS since it will also be the frame rate of this video. It's also quite useful to use your frame rate as a guide. Since I am on 60 frames per second, it means that I get 1 second of footage from 60 frames. So if I would want an animation to be half a second long, I just have to make sure that my animation consists out of 30 frames. When you create an animation in Blender and play it, you might notice that the speed of the animation is not consistent. It starts a bit slower and ends a bit slower. This is because by default, Blender's keyframes have a slight easing on the start and end. This is called interpolation and defines which values will be used on the frames between two keyframes. There are different kinds of interpolations, and they are usually visualized by a line that is drawn between two points, which visualize the keyframes. Of course, there are even more interpolations. Let's take a look at some of Blender's interpolations. To see the interpolation curves, you can open the graph editor in Blender. When clicking on normalize, the graph will be kept within the scale of the current window. Since Blender is 3D, it uses 3 different values just for scaling alone, and especially for beginners, it can be hard to keep track of them. An easy method, which I don't see a lot of coverage of in tutorials, is just right-clicking the first keyframe of an animation and then choose one of the different interpolation modes. Let's go over the most important ones. A common interpolation is the linear interpolation, which ensures that on each frame the keyframe value is increased by the same amount. Pretty useful if your keyframing settings are objects that are usually kept around the same speed, like fans. Then there also is easing, which I've mentioned before. Easing can usually be set to in, out, or in and out to control whether the start or the end of an animation should be eased. So ease in would mean the animation would start slow and then gain speed over time. Out means it slows down at the end. And in and out means you have both at the same time. The default interpolation mode is bezier, which honestly just adds a very slight easing, so you can easily modify it in the graph editor. To set whether the easing should be at the start, the end, or both, you can right-click the keyframe again and choose the easing mode. By default, it will be set to automatic, which means Blender will choose the easing depending on the interpolation mode. Speaking of, when we go to the interpolation modes, you can also choose different strengths of easing. They are ordered by the strength of the easing, so the lower easings are the most intense easings. Now we will come to more special interpolations, anticipation and overshooting. To get these interpolations in Blender, you have to set the interpolation mode to back. When we set the easing mode to ease in, we get anticipation. With anticipation, we move the object in the opposite of the initial direction before it actually starts pursuing its actual route. This can give the animation a lot more impact as it indicates the build-up of power. Just imagine throwing a ball. Before actually performing the throw motion, you will likely move your arm back first. To achieve this effect, the interpolation curve will at first go below the start value. If you have this type of interpolation at the end, by setting it to ease out, it is rather referred to as overshooting, which you can use to show that an object tries to stop a lot of force or speed. You might already be familiar with this type of motion from real life. For example, when a car performs an emergency brake and then tilts a bit to the front before getting to a full stop. You can also have both at the same time, and both interpolations are also specially used in exaggerated ways in cartoons. There are also the bounce and the elastic interpolations in Blender. The bounce interpolation is pretty straightforward, I think, and is especially useful if you let something drop on the ground. The elastic interpolation is a bit weird, as it will also change values, which would usually stay the same during the animation, and it might look a bit too snappy. I think it is supposed to look more like this. To make it work, you can expand this panel from the timeline and only apply the interpolation to a single keyframed value. Set the easing mode to ease out and then go in the graph editor and select the first keyframe of the value. Then you can play around with the amplitude and period slider to make it look more supple. When you change that to ease in, it will look a bit like sneezing. When looking at beginner animations, it's often very obvious where the keyframes are set and the transitions between them look kinda choppy. To avoid this, you can try to play around with the different interpolations. I will demonstrate this by using a camera that is parented to an empty, which you can use to rotate the camera around the center, and by scaling the empty, you can zoom in and out. A way to smoothen out your animations can be achieved by trying to stretch the easing over multiple keyframes. By setting the first keyframe to a strong ease in and the second keyframe to a strong ease out. What might also help when smoothing out animations is to separate the transformation keyframes, so you don't have all the keyframes at the same place, which helps hiding the position of the keyframes. Of course, you have the most control by using the graph editor and manually using the handles to adjust the easings. As I've mentioned before, it is hard to overview in 3D applications, but I will give you a few more tips on the way. Sometimes it's hard to not accidentally select the wrong handles. To solve this, you can lock all the values you don't want to edit. This is especially useful if you want to align the handles for the scaling, as you will probably like to keep the proportions of the object. When you have all other values locked, you can just box select all scaling values and adjust the handles. Also, by pressing V, you can change the handle type. The most relevant ones are free and auto-aligned. Free means you can move both handles independently, and auto-aligned means both handles will be kept in symmetry. And finally, the graph editor also has multiple modifiers you can use to create procedural animations. For example, you can use the noise modifier to create camera shake. There currently is a survey on the posts tab of my channel where you can vote whether the next Blender related video will be about comparing the Cycles and Octane render engines or the texturing softwares Adobe Substance and Instamate Studio. So subscribe if you don't want to miss them, and if you're from the future, one of those videos might already be on my channel. Bye!